Hey everybody, welcome to Both Sides of the Booth, episode 3. I've got Bill Reynolds, I've got Brian Standefer, and I've got Rick Nelson here. So, let's talk first recording experiences. What were those like as a string player?
The reason why I'm an engineer and own a studio to this day all started from my frustrations of string recording. So I graduated and I just started doing all these recording sessions, and like I realized that, like, you know, all these studios I was going to, they were miking violins and the cellos and the violas and everything. They didn't sound very good, and they were using the wrong microphones and the wrong placement and everything like that. And so I finally got frustrated. I'm like, well, I'm going to buy myself a good microphone and a good preamp, and I'm just going to do this and experiment at my house until I finally started like doing it on my own. And then I found, oh, okay, well, you don't put a microphone right on top of where the bridge is, because you just get all that scratchy high-end sound from the bow. You know, you need some distance, you know? So that's why I became an engineer, was just learning how to do that first and then start out recording other instruments after that.
How did you guys wind up adapting to improv versus reading first?
Well, it's interesting, I mean, and both of you probably have had this experience where you're on stage and you're actually reading music. I actually prefer not to do that, or even look at a chart, because as soon as you're doing that, it's almost like you can't interact with everybody.
Mm-hmm. And I can't stop looking at it.
Yeah, right. It's like all you're focused on is the sheet music, and you can't pull away from that and, like, you know,
interact.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah. Get what people, you know, develop that energy on stage that is from people like listening to everybody else. And
yeah, absolutely.
You know.
Bell, and he's going to tell us a little about the mic setup that we've got going. See, Aston Spirit. Tell
it's
me
beautiful
a little
mic.
Yeah, we've got the Aston Spirit set up, just the regular cardioid setting, nothing special, no roll off, nothing else. We're going to get to the sweet spot of the cello and go from there, and then we'll do a couple versions where we get maybe a little closer to the strings, grittier sound.
Yeah.
And then maybe see if I can just randomly find the not sweet spot. And then maybe we'll throw in a special mic from Aston to get some more of the low end.
Nice.
Kind of the sweet spot there, right? You're thinking, should we try a different spot?
Yeah, we could do it closer or higher. You're talking about sort of closer, getting more gritty.
Yeah, if we get closer, we'll get a little more string sound.
Okay.
And then more room, obviously, if we pull it back a little bit. We've also had, not very often, but once in a while, somebody will mic down here, and it's a little, you get more of the low end.
The low end.
But it's not, you know, you don't get that definition that you'd get from here. So we could try a close up if you want and just see the difference.
Yeah, let's do that. Just kind of leave it where it is. Go in another 3 or 4 inches.
Yeah, see what the difference is.
Okay.
Right, and I'll try and play, like, as I did before, some low stuff, some high stuff, some short things, so you can kind of get an idea of the different sound.
Perfect.
Cool.
Mm-hmm.
notice a difference when it was closer up like this?
Much more string, yeah. Mm-hmm. Much more articulation and grittier for sure. Yeah. So I'm gonna move it back to the sweet spot. Mm-hmm. And then we've got the Aston Stealth down here too.
Nice.
So we're gonna use that and kind of capture some more of that low end that we were talking about earlier.
Yeah, yeah.
So, and I've got it phantom powered, about 20 or so dBA of clean gain added to it. So
nice, okay.
We'll give that a shot and add that in with the spirit.
Let's do it.
Cool.
Any miking advice for people out there?
I think it's important to use a microphone that's got a very low noise threshold. That's one of the first things, because you want the subtleties of the strings. They can get so quiet and so soft. And certain microphones, you're going to have to crank up the preamp so much that you're going to get so much noise in the line that it's more noise than it is signal. So I think that's one of the first things, capturing the room, having several different options. You know, if you've got the channels, use as many as you possibly can, one or two over each section, or an XY pattern over each section if you possibly can. Definitely some ribbon mics in there too to capture some of the sound of the overall of the room. But yeah, you wanna make sure that those microphones are your ears. So you wanna make sure that you're hearing it as they sound in the room, and with not muddying it up by too much of the technicalities of like hearing noise, because if you're hearing noise, you're not hearing music. So that's kind of how I approach it.
Yeah. I think as string players, like you always have your instruments on you, and so you're always adapting to the room. So if like you can get the string players to create a unit, and whatever you're feeding into their headphones, so that they play as a unit rather than just like and hearing just that. Like it's like drums. If you're going to use one mic on a drums, the drummer needs to learn how to play the drums like that.
To that mic.
So it's just kind of like, that's, to me, that kind of makes the sound that people, you know, they'll play harder if they can't hear themselves. And so,
right.
And that could kind of create the sounds.
All right, we're here with Rick, and he's gonna play us some violin and some viola.
Yes.
Excellent, excellent. So tell us a little bit about your choice in mic positioning up here.
So I thought we would try the Origin today. We've tried the Spirit already, but the Origin has got a little bit more of a flatter response on the high end, because on a violin, it's already got such high frequency range, you want to kind of attenuate some of that high
end.
So this seems to be a little bit more natural of a sound. So, and I've got it placed about, you know, a foot and a half or so above the violin, so you're going to get a little bit warmer of the sound. You're not going to get so much of the
boom noise. String, yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
Thank you. maybe you could tell us about the difference between what somebody would expect from a bow on a bass versus playing with your fingers.
It's similar to what Rick was saying. Like if sometimes a producer, if I'm playing bass on it, an engineer comes up, they'll put the mic right where my bow is. I'm like, oh, that's gonna sound terrible. And you really do need some of that top end, but it's gonna sound so, it doesn't really fit in the mix well. So most people will, like, in the case of the bow, they'll bring it a lot lower, or either just like put it further in the, just like, you know, 4 feet away, yeah, and try to get the sound of the bass. But I generally try to keep it away from the bow. And when I'm playing rock or bluegrass, a lot of the times people will put the microphone in figure eight, yeah, and get it, you know, kind of, the bass has a thing called, like, I call it wolf tones, maybe other people do too, mm-hmm, where it's like, yeah, one note's way louder than the others. Mm-hmm. And especially, yeah, when you get into a small room, it's gonna be like your G's super loud.
Is it G for bass?
I don't know, maybe just, be, like it could be G or whatever it is, like the wrong note's loud. And yeah. You're like, ugh. Mm-hmm. So you kind of find that, you kind of find the place in the bass where it sort of cancels that out a little bit.
Yeah.
And one of the things I've been really into doing is I'll put a small condenser up here and aim it right at my fingers and compress the bejesus out of it. And you get that of a bass. And I really like that in a bass.
Awesome.
I like to hear like the inconsistencies and the messiness, because it's easy to get the
Yeah.
You know?
No, that's
what
great.
A great idea.
What's your favorite personal moment?
We made a record with Glenn Johns, and it's funny because it's like the Glenn Johns technique. So, like, you know, I spent a month with him, and I would like watch him figuring out like what is the Glenn Johns technique, and I know.
So we're here with Bill, and I just wanted to, we're doing this really fun hand miking technique he was talking about during our interview here.
For this mic, I like to get some of the growl out of the hands. Yeah. What I generally do is I'll aim it at my fingers and then compress it really hard. And I'm really looking for like the 2K to 5K thing.
Totally.
That just gives it that, you know, because sometimes when you have the mics way down here, you don't get a lot of the board. So I like to mic the hands and then get some more of the fundamental lows down here. The different mic. Yeah,
so we've got this one of the Starlights on, it's got the vintage settings, that's good to go, and then we've got the Spirit in figure eight, and go from there.
Okay, and figure eight, I was gonna mention that, the reason I like to put it in figure eight is because the bass waves are super long. I found that like when I put it in figure eight, like it comes back and I kind of get the whole room a little bit. This depends, if there's a mandolin over there, I probably can't put it in figure eight, but.
Totally.
This. I'll play a few things with this and try to make it growl, see if we can come up with.
Great.
Oh, thank you.
How about we do some bow stuff?
Sounds like a good idea. Okay. I'll tell you what, I personally like to have the mic a little lower for the bow, mostly to keep it out of the way and also just to get some of the high end noise out of it.
Okay.
So if you're cool with that.
On your side, sort of?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm going to take this away. We don't need that for the bow stuff. And then, yeah, let's just do like so.
Nice.
Great.
Cool.
Let's hear that. Awesome. What else do you have? Bluegrass?
Yeah.
Okay.
Let's try that new mic out for the bluegrass.
Okay, let's do it. So this is the stealth, and I do have it phantom powered, and you said sort of...
Yeah, somewhere down there to kind of keep a, you know, that more that thud thing works okay. Good for bluegrass.
Something like that is what you normally have?
Yeah, let's try that.
Okay, great.
So I thought what would be kind of cool, since all three of us are going to be playing together, is if we try a mid-side pattern, because the spirit's got that real cool, the polarity changes that you can do. We can put it in figure eight. So we can change the pattern to where, essentially, this will be canceled on either side, but one person will be picked up on this side, the other person will be picked up on this side. I'll be over here playing the violin, and that'll be picked up on the origin right here. That'll just be in the cardioid pattern. So that way, essentially, that will be canceled out, and then this will be canceled out. So essentially what you get is basic isolation on all these different things all the way around like this. I've had a lot of good, like some good success with this with like folk records. Mm-hmm. Just everybody kind of standing around one or two mics at a time and kind of having them mix themselves. So basically it's a matter of like, hey, you need to take a step back or you need to take a step forward, and essentially your record is almost completed yeah. as soon as it's done. So there's just very minimal mixing as far as that, because you're essentially mixing the way it used to be done. Everybody's standing around one mic and it's like, hey, drums in the back, mm-hmm. vocal in the front, that kind of thing. So I think this will be kind of interesting. We'll do cello on this side, bass right here, and violin, and we should get a pretty good balance. You'll just have to let us know who needs to move closer and who needs to move farther away.
Cool. Great.
Let's give it a try.